Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cathedrals of Glass, a Planet of Blood and Ice, by A.J. Hartley. Narrated by Emily Wu Zeller. Forward, by Tom DeLong. There are many things in our lives that we don't understand. For instance, how do our dogs know when we are about to arrive home? Or how do some mothers feel pain when their children are hurt, even when they are far away? And how did a man bend a spoon with his mind, as witnessed by a powerful head of state? We don't know the answers to these questions, but there is no disputing that these strange things do happen. Did you know that scientists proved plants can feel human intent? They proved that the plants knew when they were threatened, cherished, and even when their human owners were having sexual intercourse in the next room. For every grain of sand on all the beaches in the world, there is a synapse in your brain, a connection organically formed to store information, solve problems, and access the infinite. Over time, humans are expected to achieve great things if we put our minds to it, as the saying goes. When I met A.J. Hartley, I had him perfectly matched in my mind to write Secret Machines, a story that spans as much space itself as it does events connected to consciousness, coming in book 3. But then A.J. mentioned he had another story that he had just written that he called Eyes in the Dark. At first, the title seemed too cliché to me, but upon experiencing the story, I realized it made perfect sense. But still, I felt there was something else out there we could find that sounded more poetic, more ominous. AJ has a gift for words and for imagination. These gifts are displayed in all of his novels. What caught me off guard this time was something else completely. He was playing with the delicate and diverse perceptions of the human mind. Consciousness itself was a character. That resonated with me, and thus with what To the Stars is all about. I have about 50 stories I want to tell, so there is not that much room in my kitchen. I'm like a pissed-off grandmother baking on Christmas morning. Don't dare enter! But then here comes this guy with a damned good recipe, and most of it is already cooked. It just needs a nice plate, and a party that is hungry. And here you have our collaboration. We worked on a new title, and after a series of wordplay and thought clusters, we landed on Cathedrals of Glass, a play on the mountainous landscape within the story that is composed of a beautiful but deadly mix of sharpened glass and ice. What I love about the play on the word cathedrals is much of the esotericism behind the monuments themselves. Did you know that ancient cathedrals contain a long-forgotten science that is full of what the architects call sacred geometry? It was architecture that somehow managed to resonate certain unnatural frequencies with human biology, creating a resonant oscillator with the human mind. What a wild concept! There is a lot that we just don't fucking know. And that is why I started my company, To the Stars. Because we need to know more. And by sorting these mysterious concepts within a cohesive explanation or story, they all may just start to make sense to people. And in turn, reignite that forgotten part of human experience from our distant past. Atlantis, anyone? Oh, wait. That is Secret Machines Book 2. I keep getting ahead of myself here. When we evolve over the next few hundred years, I truly believe humanity will change profoundly. All the conspiratorial and esoteric concepts about religious rites, rituals, sacred geometry, remote viewing, ESP, telepathy, and astral travel will become normal science. And we will long forget our Texas Instruments calculators, because there will be a rediscovered Apple supercomputer in the ether. one that we can access whenever we desire. And which is way more fun to use than the latest iPhone. Cathedrals of Glass, a planet of blood and ice, explores these questions. What are souls? Where do they go? What is consciousness, and where does it live? What is the power of the human mind? And what is the threat of it unleashed? Are ghosts, consciousness, and etheric apparitions all part of the same galactic operating system? Or are we to blame for those incarnations ourselves? Literally forming matter and physical holograms out of mind power. As if the human mind itself can assemble a tangible, organic property out of invisible waves of light? Some call those waves of probability. Maybe an apparition is just a hologram your mind believed into existence. Because when you believe something truly and totally, well, maybe you actually can walk on water like Jesus. Hell, I bet you could walk on fire itself, like they do in those far-out Middle Eastern rituals. Or maybe you could commit to something more necessary, like changing the weather, as the Native Americans did during those legendary rain dances we heard so much about as kids. Either way, we must not pretend we know how to contain the potential of the human mind. We must not try to predict it, ignore it, or worse, not use it. Cathedrals of Glass, a planet of blood and ice, will give you a violent tow up Supernatural Mountain, and then drop you into the dark, forbidding abyss. The story is modern and cerebral, told through the eyes and ears of young adults along isolated and troubled paths. Here, life and death are at their doorstep, and the universe likes to play tricks. People can die from such nefarious games. After reading Cathedrals, you will think twice about what is real and what is possible. And then maybe you yourself can learn how to dance across that delicate boundary of human existence. Like walking on water, fire, or making the sky rain. Oh yeah, or bending metal spoons with your mind. 1. I was awake when the ship started to dive. I shouldn't have been, but I was wandering the ship by myself before the others woke up. It was just the kind of minor rebelliousness that had gotten me shipped off to the reeducation facility in the first place. Ironically, it saved my life. Saved all of our lives, in fact. For a while. We were supposed to wake up after the journey was 95% done, giving us just a little time to come to so we weren't too groggy for our first lecture on how to be better citizens. But I'd been on these rust buckets twice before. The transit agent had mouthed the numbers of her access code as she typed them in, and moments later my fingers had flashed unseen over the controls as I smiled into her glacial stare. "Vermin," said her eyes. "Deviant." I was used to that. And from people who mattered to me a good deal more than some stone-faced security drone. On waking, it took me about 5 minutes to realize that something was wrong. As I waited for the nausea to pass, I disconnected the electrodes on my temples, pulled out the IV line, and took a sip of water from the bottle in my comfort package. I cracked the lid of the pod, onto which I had stuck an ancient picture of an angel, and peered out. When I was satisfied that no one else was moving about, I climbed out into the dark hull of the ship. It was called the Phetteron, one of a fleet of identical transports that had been in service at least 50 years. A pilotless drone, equipped with none of the comforts of home. It was little more than a subsectioned metal box with an engine. I sniffed. The air was cool and lifeless, edged with the muted tang of fuel and iron. It was a ship from another age. About as far from the sleek glass and plastic and chrome that had been the backdrop of my life to date as I could imagine. I'd had 16 years of the polished, clean, and tech-dependent world that was home. There you never saw the insides of things. Only the gleaming surface. The Phetteron, by contrast, was a wheezing study of insides. It was bare and practical and almost embarrassingly exposed. A place of braces and cables and long smeared seams made by welding equipment. It made me think of bones and sinews, like I was inside a living thing. You could almost sense the men who had once bolted it together in a former age, when people did things with their hands, muscles straining, sweat beating on their foreheads. It was an image most girls my age would find repellent, but bodily stuff didn't bother me as much as it should. Part of the reason I had wound up on this miserable jaunt in the first place. I found my way to the vision port beyond the other stasis pods. 10 of them, one for each of us. On home, we lived in family units, each individual in his or her own subunits, and our communication with others, even our parents, was almost entirely virtual, regardless of how far apart we were in geographical space. We were private people. Everyone on home was. And being physically close to others, particularly to strangers, produced a discomfort close to panic. Partly as a result, it was satisfying to walk again. Few people on home would react to the confinement by wanting to move around, but the artificial gravity units on these old transports generated less than an entire G. So if you focused, you could sense your own lightness as you moved around. It wasn't much, and most people wouldn't notice it. But I took long, high strides, enjoying the fractional delay, the feeling of poise and gracefulness. It was, I imagined, a bit like being a dancer. Even here, effectively alone in space, the idea embarrassed me a little. When I reached the vision port, I pulled the manual release lever and pushed up the blind. Though I'd woken early, I should have been able to see Jerem, the moon where the reeducation facility was located, lining up with the ship. But there was no sign of it. Weird. I pressed my face to the cold glass of the port and gazed out at the blackness and silence of space, pushing away the memory of my parents seeing me off, the grief in my mother's face. The disappointment. The way my father kept fiddling with the cuffs of his jacket and looking around as if afraid someone would see. For a long moment, I just sat there, listening to the creak and drone of the ship. It sounded like breathing. Where the hell was that moon? I made my way up to the flight deck over a narrow gantry made of perforated metal plates, past the steps down to the engine room and storage hold, and tried the door. Locked. But there was a monitor built into the adjacent bulkhead. I tried the transit agent's access code and, when it got me into the system, went straight to check the navigation log. The numbers were all wrong. The journey from home to Jerem took 6 days. We had only been put in stasis because there was nothing to do on board a minimal transport like this. And because making sure we slept all the way meant there was no need for a crew. The whole flight was automated. 6 days. But I scrolled back through entry after entry. Days apart. Weeks. I stared, my heart hammering hard in my throat as I checked and double-checked. What the hell? We had been in space for over a month. There was no sign of Jerem ahead because we had flown right by it weeks ago. Now we were speeding through the black towards God alone knew what. I switched the screen to display the forward view, and in the same instant the ship rolled hard to the left. A vast, pale planet slid into place, filling the screen. It was blue-gray and covered with what looked to be a swirling fog. I knew what it was instantly. Everyone on home did. Its picture was on every educational interface unit in every authorized city. It was Valkrys. The ice planet. Home's uninhabited, uninhabitable neighbor. A place so hostile that even unmanned ships did not attempt to navigate the asteroid field that surrounded it. No. We were already close enough to see that the dusty haze surrounding the planet was actually made up of a billion irregular rocks. It might as well have been a minefield. We weren't going to Jerem. We were going to Valkrys. Worse, we had arrived, and now we were going down. Which meant that we were dead. No contrary position viable. A home phrase I had always despised, but that had never seemed more apt. The deck tilted under my feet, too fast for me to regain my balance. My hip slammed against the control panel as I fought to stay upright. We were rolling, the ship groaning as she began a slow, downward spiral, corkscrewing into the asteroid field. This wasn't a landing. It was a crash. I stared at the cascading digits of the altimeter. Then I felt the first shudder of the ship's hull as an asteroid cannoned off the side. The impact broke the spell, and I doubled back into the passenger hold, my feet pounding the metal decking. There was another asteroid bang, and our momentum seemed to stall for a moment. Then a third, bigger this time, followed by the yawn of creaking metal. We were coming apart. A looping siren began to shriek. The ship kicked right, rolling now, out of control. I stumbled, then made my faltering way the final 10 yards to where a faded red button sat under a clear protective housing. I mashed it with my palm. Another cycling alarm began, honking like some foghorn from centuries ago. And then every stasis pod was hissing as their covers disengaged. My companions for reeducation on this off-world death trap were, like me, delinquents, attitudinal subversives, and behavioral deviants. I had just woken them up. 2. Coming out of stasis is always nauseating, but to wake up in a ship that is spinning from one asteroid collision to another was about as close to hell as I could imagine. A boy threw up. One of the girls started screaming. "Shut up!" I yelled. "All of you! We're crashing! We have minutes, maybe less. Someone needs to take the helm and land this thing. Does anyone know anything about flying? Games, even? Simulators?" For a moment, they just stared at me, shocked and offended that I was talking directly to them like this. Most were dressed in their sleek, fashionable home clothes, all buttons and zippers and glossy fabrics. They were what you wore in your booth for online chatting and virtual parties, and they made you look like an AirNet model selling synthazine. Trendy, clean, polished. Here, in the gloomy, stripped-down interior of the ancient transport, the group looked absurd, out of their depth. A girl with short black hair, dyed with patches of fiery orange, shot me a disbelieving, contemptuous look. But before anyone could say anything, there was a deafening clang as another asteroid struck the hull. The ship kicked to the side, and something mechanical in the vessel's guts let out a juddering whine. We weren't going to last much longer. One of the other boys, tall, athletic, and wearing what looked like a uniform, shook his head as if to clear it and moved towards me. He was pale with shock, but nodded as he braced himself for another asteroid strike and said, "I'm an Air Force cadet. Let me look at the controls." The cadets were the youth training division of Home Security Services. They were still divided in the old military classifications: Army, Air Force, Navy, Intelligence, But since there was barely anyone left to fight, they were really just a branch of the government police. That someone on board might know his way around the ship was about as close to good news as seemed possible. I ran clumsily back to the flight deck without a word, clinging to the girders as something somewhere snapped and the gantry started to swing.
"Hell of a way to wake a guy up!"
yelled the boy over the din. He had a hard, angular face. Good-looking, I supposed, but with a little too much of the skull about it, a feature emphasized by his close-cut hair. I got out of the way so he could see the flight deck access panel. The others were coming after him, some urgent, some hesitant, all scared. The girl who had been screaming started up again. She still hadn't left her stasis pod. I punched the transit agent's code into the pad, but it flashed red. Locked. Having a pilot wasn't much use if we couldn't get to the controls. It was typical of Home Gov to pack us off in this can without trusting us to control it if something went wrong.
"Let me try," said the boy.
His face looked clammy from stasis, probably feeling the pitch and yaw of the ship even more than I was. But he was either playing it cool or clinging to some vestige of his cadet training. He swiped his ID through the lock mechanism, then tapped a half dozen keystrokes into the pad. It turned green, and something disengaged with a heavy clunk. He nodded, unsmiling, and twisted the release handle, resting the twin doors apart just wide enough for us to squeeze through. The cabin had a pair of empty seats and a bank of lifeless controls. With hurried taps of his fingers, the boy woke a set of sleeping screens as he slid into the left-hand chair. The nose of the ship was paneled with transparent viewers, and the gray planet filled our field of vision, clouded with a thousand floating rocks that shot past us as we dived. Another glimpse of hell.
"Well?"
I demanded. He glanced over his shoulder into the passenger hold, then returned his gaze to the Phetteron's operational center. Despite the veering ship and the terrible noise, he was eerily calm.
"I guess I'm our best hope,"
he said, flipping switches and studying the screens.
"Now, if you could keep the others quiet so I can think."
He turned a handle and punched three buttons in rapid succession. A display flickered into life and something beeped. The sirens died, and there was a sudden, unnerving silence. Through the windows ahead, the asteroids seemed to be getting thicker and larger. One direct hit on the nose, and that would be it. I moved back to the door and addressed the black-haired girl. She was about my age, or near enough, with dark skin and wide eyes that had none of the sneering composure with which she had considered me moments before.
"Keep them quiet," I said. "He knows what he's doing. Just needs to concentrate."
And then I dragged the cabin door closed. In spite of everything, I found myself momentarily embarrassed to be alone with this strange boy. The ship shuddered, and the lightness I had felt when I first started moving around the hold suddenly increased, as if my stomach had floated out of my body. I grabbed hold of the wall and manhandled my way into the co-pilot seat.
"We're losing artificial gravity," I said.
The boy said nothing. Without the echoing of the main hold, the quiet was unnerving. I turned to him, irritated, but saw that he had taken hold of the angled attitude control bars and was pulling them toward his chest. His teeth clenched. I checked the forward viewer. An asteroid lay dead ahead and closing fast. It was huge, filling the window like a wall of rock.
"Can you..."
I began.
"Remember what I said about quiet,"
he remarked, not taking his eyes off the windows in front of him.
"And don't touch anything. These seats are equipped with an ejection system that will blow you straight out into the air. Since there isn't any out there right now, that would be bad."
With that, he twisted the control bars hard to the left, and the ship rolled and banked as the asteroid seemed to float up to the right. There was a thud and a squeal of metal. but instead of peeling the ship open and exposing us to the void of space, the asteroid drifted past.
Close, I muttered.
I got past one asteroid, he answered, not looking at me. There are thousands. Where the hell are we?
Valkrys, I said.
He looked at me then, a quick, hard look full of raw emotion so powerful I could almost feel it. But he didn't dispute what I'd said. I've only got partial control, he said. I can point the ship where I want it to go, which might get us through the asteroids if we're very lucky. But I can't fight the pull of the planet. We're going down. The only question is,
whether we land or crash?
Oh no, he said, with a bleak smile. The question is whether I can keep enough of the hull intact so that we don't all get roasted to a crisp as we enter the atmosphere. We're definitely going to crash.
I stared at him. He shrugged.
Maybe if we can find a nice open spot, he conceded. We can crash gently.
Just get us down, I said, unamused. He yanked hard on the controls, and the ship slewed to the right, out of the path of another hurtling asteroid.
You're full of commands for someone whose contribution so far has been sitting, he added. So long as I'm flying this thing, I'm in charge. Captain Seven. And you are?
Sola, I replied, tartly. And if I hadn't woken you, you wouldn't have had the opportunity to show what an ace pilot you are.
Fine. And if we get out of this alive, he answered, which right now doesn't seem that likely, we can discuss why you were awake before the rest of us and why we're halfway across the solar system instead of being bored to death by home's finest reeducators.
I shot him a hard look. You think I had something to do with why we're here? I demanded.
No offense, he said,
still unnervingly calm.
But none of us are what you might call model citizens, so ditch the righteous indignation. Put your energy into something useful, like sealing off aft quadrant 4. Looks like we're on the point of a hull breach. That panel there, see, where I'm pointing.
He did it without looking at me. I found the control and threw the switch.
Better, he said. Now, brace yourself. We're going down.
3. The asteroids were gone, and the ship's descent was perhaps more controlled than it had been, but we were going down fast and hard, spearing through the atmosphere. The windows first fogged, then glowed amber. I could smell burning. The cabin was suddenly sweltering.
We gonna make it? I asked.
I didn't want to, but the words just came out. For a moment, Seven said nothing.
I felt what I couldn't see in his sweating face. Doubt. Terror. Hopelessness.
But then he forced a smile and replied almost casually.
Ask me again in 5 minutes. If we can talk about it, I'd say we did okay.
I had no response to that. And even if I had, my attention was suddenly seized by a noise unlike any we'd heard so far. A sharp crack followed by a rumble that shook the red-hot ship from nose to tail. What the hell was that? I muttered, unstrapping myself from the co-pilot's seat.
Nothing good, said Seven,
eyes locked unblinking on the glowing windshield. As soon as I released the safety buckle, I felt myself floating out of the seat. The artificial grav unit was shot.
I'd stay strapped in if I were you, said Seven.
I ignored him, blundering back to the bulkhead door and hitting the release button, my feet no longer touching the metal decking. There was a dull clunk, and I pulled at the handle, bracing myself against the wall for leverage. The formed steel slid unevenly open, one side grinding and eventually sticking halfway shut.
The hold beyond was full of thick brown smoke that smelled of electricity and burnt rubber.
Sit down!
Seven called after me. But I ignored him. I squeezed through, grabbing the cabin's fire extinguisher as I went, and tried to see what was going on through the smog. The gantry still swung precariously. At the far end were the ranks of stasis pods. Boys on the left, girls on the right. Below us, the crippled engines whined and snarled. And directly ahead was a flickering orange light. The stern was on fire. It was impossible to tell how much of the unbearable heat was coming from the exterior of the hull and how much was the blaze inside. But it didn't matter. I cocked the extinguisher and made for the firelight, pulling myself along the gantry with one hand, shooting the extinguisher ahead of me with the other. Great plumes of carbon dioxide smoke came out, reducing visibility still further. I moved between the stasis pods, spraying wherever I saw flames, vaguely aware that there was no other sign of life. The others had taken refuge in their pods and closed them. Probably smart. They were at least restrained. I, by contrast, was balancing on the ruined metal walkway, both hands on the extinguisher, when a piece of the ship's tail tore free. One moment I was peering into an impenetrable wall of smoke. The next there was a sudden blaze of light. The smoke vanished as a wind caught me up and threw me toward the ceiling where the rear bulkhead had been, but where there was now nothing at all. A wide expanse of freezing, empty air. No ceiling. No roof of any kind. Just a swirling, airless gale that felt like it might tear the ship to pieces. I seized the gantry, clinging with both hands as the fire extinguisher flew from my hands and into the abyss, feeling my legs floating free as the hole in the roof tried to suck me out into the sky. The raging heat of re-entry had gone entirely, which meant we were low. And through the horror of the moment, I remember thinking quite clearly that Seven had done as well as anyone could expect. That he might actually get us to the ground. That if I could just hold on for a few more seconds. And then I felt the impact. The ship buckled as if it was made of card, tearing open like a gutted fish. And suddenly there was only brilliant light and searing, blinding pain. Then nothing. 4. I dreamed of home. Not the sleek booths and virtual gatherings. Not the airnet commercials for the latest pads and gadgets. Not the massive broadcast screens where smiling cybermodels read the news and briefed the populace on changes in behavioral law. Not the ever-present slogan, "Home looks after its own." I dreamed of the home I only saw when I went roaming. That's what they called it when you slipped out after curfew or strayed beyond your designated range. I'd been caught 3 times, which was why I was on this transport in the first place, bound for a week's re-education. Again. There they would ask the question they always asked. Why do you do it? You know it's against the law. You know it's dangerous to stray beyond the protection of your personal security zone. You know it risks interaction with people who live outside the law. That it might involve actual physical contact with other human beings in ways contrary to taste and safety. You know it means coming off the tech grid and leaving the designated sanitized zone that the home governmental agency created for your own good. You know that you're exposing yourself to the risk of bodily harm and emotional trauma. And you don't even try to do anything but walk around. You know no contrary position is viable. You know home can't look after its own if you don't let us. So why? Why do you do it? I couldn't answer. I didn't know why I did it. I just did. And that was what I dreamed of. Slipping out of my room and out of our 26th floor apartment, reprogramming the elevator so that it would take me down even after the curfew lockdown, rigging the service entrance so that I could shimmy through the delivery hatch, dirtying my immaculate pants on the oil as I did so, smiling at the stain, rubbing it with my fingers, then rolling out across the gravel and up into a run. An actual run! Feet pounding, blood pumping, chest heaving, sweat pouring, hair streaming. Out through the empty streets of Syndrome where the towering halls of servers rose like the cathedrals of old. Alone in the world. Touching the walls with my fingers, my cheek. Lapping up the sensation of contact, of openness, of freedom. I felt it in my body. Not my head. That I had left behind with my compad. I felt it in my thighs, my lips, my fingertips. I felt it stir in my gut. And as I was experiencing it, I felt only joy and exhilaration. No embarrassment. No shame. That was why I had to be reeducated. Normally, when I dreamed of roaming, I awoke to confusion and embarrassment as the exhilaration of the dream died. I'd lie still for 20 minutes or more, wondering what was wrong with me. Not today. Today, I woke quickly, and the first thing I registered was the cold. It was bitter, biting, unlike anything I had ever experienced. There was a hard, chill light that cast deep black shadows through the belly of the ravaged ship. The ship. I was on a crippled transport. The Phetteron. I had never reached the facility on Jerem. I was struck by a sudden panic and tried to get up.
"Easy," said a voice. "You've had a bad fall. And there are lots of hard edges around you. Take a moment to wake up properly before you start jumping about."
He was so close. I felt my throat tighten with something just this side of revulsion at the proximity of the boy. "Seven?" I said. "We made it?"
"In a manner of speaking,"
he said.
"We're down. And everyone is still alive. But we took some serious knocks."
"How serious?" I asked, sitting up.
"The people or the ship?"
"Both."
"The people are mostly fine. Physically. A few cuts and bruises. One of the girls has a nasty gash on her head that needs attending to. And one of the boys has what looks like a broken arm."
"A broken arm?" I echoed. "How can you tell?" His confidence flickered.
"Read about them in the cadet manual,"
he said.
"Symptoms seem to fit."
"How are they doing mentally?"
He took a breath and shook his head.
"I don't know which is worse,"
he said.
"The fact that we aren't where we were supposed to be, that we crashed, or that we're all stuck together here only a few feet apart."
"And the ship?"
"Done,"
he said.
"I'm amazed it held together as well as it did. But we lost an entire panel from the aft section and the engines are fried. We're not going anywhere."
Since landing, he had put on the jacket from his cadet uniform, navy blue and trimmed with piping. There were a pair of brass studs on the collar. Insignia or rank, I supposed. He was probably just wearing the jacket for warmth. But it gave him an air of authority. "Have you been outside?" I asked, trying to sound like it was an ordinary question.
"You remember where we are, right?"
he said, eyebrows raised and voice lowered. I started to say the name, but caught myself. No need to cause a panic just yet.
"Exactly," said Seven. "So take a moment to come to, and then we'll talk properly."
I nodded,
which made my head pound so badly that I stopped and squeezed my eyes shut. When I opened them, he had gone.
"Quite the commander,"
said a boy lying beside me. He was cradling his left arm across his chest. Apparently, he was the one with a broken arm. His sleeve was almost touching mine.
"Seven?" I said, fighting the impulse to cringe away. "We wouldn't be here without him."
"I meant you," said the boy.
He was pale, dark-haired, with blue-gray eyes. Handsome, but less angular than Seven. It was a face you could trust, or at least one you wanted to.
"Seven just took the controls when you told him to," he said. "I'm Bryce, by the way. Strange, just saying it like that."
I gave him a sympathetic nod. I couldn't remember the last time I had met someone in person without being introduced via VidChat first. I wasn't sure I ever had. And even the closest friends and family kept further apart than the inches between me and this boy.
"Sola," I said. Awkward.
It felt like we should do something really old school, like shake hands or something. And I was momentarily glad his arm was broken so he wouldn't consider trying. He smiled, but it was almost a wince. And when he shifted, trying to get comfortable, his shoulder touched mine. I sat up, trying to hide the way I shrank away from him, but he saw it anyway. I heard his flash of embarrassment and irritation, which was crazy, because you couldn't hear such things.
"What?"
I asked.
"I didn't say anything,"
he answered. "Right," I said, more uncomfortable still. I looked directly into his face, into his eyes. And for a moment it was like having vertigo, a wild sense of tumbling, as if the ship were still plunging through space and I were falling into his mind. For a fraction of a second, it was like we had changed places. I could feel the throbbing pain in his arm, his unease at being so close to me, his mounting outrage and panic when he felt the link between us. It broke immediately. For a moment, we just stared at each other, baffled and uncomfortable. Then I fled. I scrambled to my feet and steadied myself. My vision swam as I looked around the battered, wreckage-strewn hull. Then I made for where the others had gathered. I shrugged off whatever that had been with Bryce. I had, after all, had a hard fall.
"Can't believe I broke my arm,"
he said wonderingly.
"Who does that? It's like something that happened hundreds of years ago. You think they can still fix it? When we get home, I mean?"
"I'm sure," I said, more to keep his spirits up than because I really was. I had never heard of anyone actually breaking a bone.
"Our savior, I presume,"
said another boy. He was lean, not as tall as Bryce or Seven, tanned with black hair, dark eyes the same slim shape as mine, and an open, smiling face. He'd wrapped the blanket from his stasis pod around his shoulders against the cold.
"Sola, right? My name's Trest. I know, stupid name. Normally I'd warn you in advance with the text, but here I guess I just have to say it, which is several kinds of weird. It was my father's. The name, I mean. I tried to give it back to him and call myself something sensible like plant pod or landfill, but no one was buying it. The problem with names is that it doesn't matter how cool they are if no one else will call you them. I'm babbling. Sorry. I deal with stress by throwing words at it. People get caught in the crossfire."
"It's cool," I said, smiling. "I'm kind of the opposite. But I know what you mean."
"Strong and silent," said Trest. "Excellent. Very commandery. You and Brigadier General Seven will have us back in the sky in time for tea. Not actual tea, of course. figure of speech.
Not so sure about that, I said, eyeing the sky showing through the roof at the far end of the hold.
Right, said Trest, following my gaze. Because the ship is sort of broken.
You could say that.
What, with a massive hole and all?
Trest agreed.
Right. Could make it tough to breathe in space.
A little bit, I said, smiling again. I'm looking for a girl with a head wound.
Now there's a sentence you don't often hear,
said Trest.
Amazingly, I don't have one. A head wound, I mean.
Or a girl, for that matter. I nodded. You know where she is? I asked.
Over there,
said Trest, nodding.
Her name is Carl Ann.
Okay. Thanks, I said, fighting down the unease I felt at having so many people so close to me.
Well, I'll leave you to figure out our salvation,
said Trest, smiling back and bobbing his head in a self-deprecating nod.
Without being subjected to a string of verbal idiocy.
It's nice to meet you, I said.
Yeah?
Said Trest, clearly surprised and pleased, though the remark seemed to fluster him still further.
Right. You're nice to meet, too.
I grinned, and he flushed.
Oh, and I like the hair,
he said, nodding at the patch I had dyed over my right eye.
Very blue.
Thanks, I said. My mom isn't a fan. I said it lightly, like it didn't really matter.
I got this ear chain,
he said, fingering a loop of tiny silver links that ran from the top of his ear round the edge to the lobe.
Makes people think I have a personality,
he added, grinning. I think they'd get that anyway, I answered.
I'm going to go now,
he said, nodding over to a corner where some of the others had gathered.
Over there. Safely out of earshot so you can recover. But you should prepare yourself for more babbling later.
I'll count on it, I said, still smiling, though it took an effort. All these people so close together, talking like we knew each other. It was more than unsettling. I was relieved to note that the others seemed a lot less comfortable talking than Trest. The black and orange-haired girl was sitting by herself, watching everyone in silence. And there was a blonde boy who had his hands over his eyes as if trying to shut the whole situation out. Carl Ann, the girl with the head wound, was the one who had been screaming. She had been too scared to move when everyone else had returned to their stasis pods during the crash, and one of the guidance struts had lashed across the top of her head when the tail section came free. She wasn't screaming now. She was quite still and silent, her face white with fear beneath a slick, crimson mask of blood. Red spattered the front of her fashionable gray clothes and the beaded necklace she wore around her throat. She was about 15, maybe less. Seven was examining her, but he looked like he'd rather be flying through asteroids. Let me see, I said. Seven backed off, relieved to turn the injured girl over to someone else. No one else was close enough to touch her. But that was home people for you. We don't like bodies, and we really don't like to see them damaged and oozing. Reminds us we aren't just minds. I squatted down and took her face in my hands. Even in her terror, she flinched at the intimacy of the intrusion. Sorry, I said. I just need to see. Your name's Carl Ann? Yes, whispered the girl. Don't touch me. I just want to look. Am I going to die? No, Carl Ann, I said. Just tip your head forward. She did so, and the blood flowing down her face increased. One of the other girls gasped and shifted back, as if Carl Ann might be contagious. I'm going to need some scissors, I said, shooting them a hard look. See what you can find.
They scattered, glad of a reason to be elsewhere and apart. Seven looked at me, then nodded.
Even on an automated ship like this, there should be an emergency locker,
he said, rising.
I'll see if I can locate it below decks.
What are you going to do? Asked Carl Ann. I want to talk to my parents.
I just want to get a look at the wound, I said. That means I need to cut your hair.
My hair?
Said Carl Ann, despairing. Sorry, but it will grow back.
Can't it wait till we get home?
Just need to be sure nothing needs doing now, I said, glad that Seven was out of earshot.
Will it hurt?
She asked. No, I said, smiling again. My fingers were slick with blood. It was amazing the girl was still conscious. I tested her skull gently, feeling for indentations or soft patches, but it felt whole and hard. With luck, the gash would turn out to be a superficial wound, though it needed to be closed. I like your necklace, I said.
It's a choker,
she answered in a tone that suggested she was used to correcting people on this point. One of the girls came running back to me holding something in the air. A transparent plastic box. She was black and, at about 11 years old, was the youngest on board. Her triumph was mingled with embarrassment.
Sewing kit,
she explained, thrusting it at me.
Where on earth did you find that?
I asked, opening it and taking out a pair of silver scissors.
Clever girl.
She looked away. It's yours? I said, trying to sound merely curious.
I'm not supposed to have it, said the girl. But I wanted something to do at the facility. I love real games, of course, she added hastily, on the pads and screens. But sometimes I like to...
Her enthusiasm dried up as her embarrassment won out. Sometimes you like to do things with your hands, I completed for her. The girl just nodded, so I smiled to show I wasn't judging her. Sewing made no less sense than roaming, I supposed. Okay, I said to Carl Ann. I'm going to cut some of the hair from the back. I'll take as little as I can and make it so you'll be able to brush the rest over the spot. You ready? Carl Ann tensed, then nodded.
I'm cold, she said.
She had been clinging to her blanket like a toddler, more for security than warmth. But she released it to me when I tugged at it. I wrapped it around her shoulders and tucked it in. Better? I said.
No,
she said.
But it will be. Thanks.
I'm going to start now, I said.
Okay, said the girl. Don't tell me about it.
I began to cut, slipping the scissor blades as close to the scalp as I could get them, feeling gingerly with my fingers before shearing off Carl Ann's rich chestnut hair. The younger girl who had supplied the sewing kit watched, fascinated. When the first locks fell away, she pushed them out of sight with her shoe so that Carl Ann wouldn't be upset at how much I had cut. I gave her a grateful look, and she smiled briefly, eyes fastened on the blood-flecked scissors.
I'm Muse,
she volunteered, pronouncing it like there was a Y after the M.
I'm disobedient.
I grinned at her. I think you're in good company, I said. I turned Carl Ann's head into the light and froze. The wound was perhaps 3 inches long and bleeding freely. But that wasn't what had made the breath catch in my throat.
Just beneath the cut, right in the center of her head, was a tattoo of a triangle, its sides lined with deep red ink. Muse gaped.
But she read my look and hurriedly turned away.
What? Asked Carl Ann. Is it bad?
It's fine, I said. But we need to close it. Carl Ann shrank away.
I'll wait till we get home, she said.
I hesitated at that, suddenly aware that the others had grown quiet and watchful. I sensed them looking at us, waiting to see what I would say.
"We're not going home,"
said Seven, coming up the aft stairs and onto the metal gangway lugging a plastic crate.
"Not anytime soon."
Carol-Ann gasped, and, as she began to sob, I shot him a hard look.
"No point lying about it,"
said Seven, brash as ever.
"The ship is crippled. There's a hole in it as big as a skyball table. Or hadn't you noticed? And the closest moon or planet is weeks away. The F-950 is 5 times as fast as this piece of junk,"
said the boy with the shock of blonde hair.
"And has a range of 250 pecs,
said Seven with a steely grin.
"Anything that can reach us out here will do twice our speed at most."
"But home looks after its own," said Carl-Ann. "No contrary position is viable. They'll come for us."
She said it lightly, reassured by the familiarity of the idea. No one pulled a face or rolled their eyes. We might have been, in small ways, rebels. But there were some things we just accepted, new in our innermost being. Home might be a bit dull, synthetic, and restrictive, but it was also essentially benevolent.
"Of course they'll come for us,"
said Seven, as if nothing could be more obvious.
"And maybe rescue is already en route. But it's going to take a while, so you'd better get used to the idea of waiting here on this rock."
They stared at him. The blonde boy frowned at the compad he had been playing with and then looked up with desperate eyes.
"Where can I charge this?"
he said.
"Main power is offline,"
said Seven,
"and won't be coming back on. There's a backup generator that will give us a little energy for essentials, which doesn't include playing Gnarl Herder on your pad. And there's a solar panel we might be able to hook up to give it a boost. But whatever power we can scrape together should be used for light and heat. If we don't get some warmth in here, we'll freeze to death."
It might have been just a figure of speech, but it might not. On home, where practically no one had to actually go outside, the temperature of life was constant and stable regardless of season. The air in the ship was cold in ways I had never known before. A cold that made you feel as if your bones were made of metal. And the temperature was, I suspected, falling. Carl-Ann's pale face now had a bluish tinge, and her lips had turned a thin lilac color that I didn't like.
"Wasn't going to play Gnarl Herder," said the blonde boy. "Was going to send a pulse to my parents." "There's no signal out here,"
said Seven.
"You won't be able to do much with your compad, and you certainly can't send a pulse."
Everyone looked up then, their faces blank as if Seven was speaking a strange language. One of them put a hand to her mouth, her eyes brimming.
"I don't understand,"
said the boy. He did. He just couldn't deal with the idea.
"There's no signal,"
said Seven again, ignoring the frightened looks around him and keeping his face impassive.
"We're on our own. Not that tough to grasp."
But it was, however lightly he tossed the phrase off. I doubted any of them had ever been without a signal before. It was like losing a limb. Worse, even, because limbs were just body parts. This was like losing the world. The others were all standing apart or sitting with their arms and legs tight to their bodies, putting as much distance from each other as the cramped ship would allow. Several of them held their blank and silent compads and stared at them as if willing them to come to life, pointedly not looking at each other. If I closed my eyes, I thought with a shudder, I could probably smell them. For a moment, it was all I could do not to climb back into my stasis pod and close the lid.
"What's in the emergency store?"
asked the boy with the broken arm. Bryce. I think he said it just to break the awful silence.
"Not enough,"
said Seven,
A couple of flashlights, some emergency medical supplies, a battery-powered space heater, some blankets, a crate of bottled water, and some protein bars. Food for a few days if we're careful. There's no dermabond or anything like that,
he added, looking at me. The wound needs closing, I said, with careful emphasis. We didn't have time to debate the matter.
How?
Asked Seven.
The old-fashioned way, I said, managing a smile.
Muse looked anxious.
What's that? She asked. Just a few stitches should do it, I said. Muse, can I see that sewing kit again, please?
Carlan's eyes went very wide as she fixed her gaze on the sewing kit. When I removed the needle, she started to shake her head.
No, she said. I'll be fine.
No, I said firmly. You won't. I have to close it, and I have to do it now.
I don't understand, said one of the girls. We were supposed to be on Jerem. We were supposed to only be on the ship for 5 days. Where are we? Why is it so cold?
What we need to focus on, I said, is keeping calm and safe while I take care of Carlan here. Valkrys, said Seven. We're on Valkrys.
Even without the gasps, the groans of horror, you could feel the effect of the word on the huddled kids. The already frigid ship seemed to dip well below freezing.
It can't be, said Muse. He's not right, is he?
I frowned at Seven, but there was no point dodging the truth.
He's right, I said.
They all started talking at once, venting expletives, demanding explanations, crying, apologizing out loud to their parents for the indiscretions that had put them on this nightmare trip. Some punched desperately at their comm pads, determined to find a signal they knew couldn't possibly be there.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.